Welcome everybody to this public lecture today by Professor Elmar Altvater on academia, activism and alternatives, strategies for politicizing ecology in precarious times. Let me just explain a little bit about the context of this lecture. This is taking place and was organized by the ENTITLE, the European Network for Political Ecology. We're a group of academics, established academics, postdocs, and PhD students around Europe and also in Istanbul and Chile. And we're working primarily on environmental conflicts from a political ecology perspective. And our intention is to explain political ecology and do radical critical research. All over the world. Now we're holding a workshop in Berlin on the question of how political ecologists can navigate careers and in these precarious times that we are facing, arguably with issues such as high unemployment all over the world. The question poses itself how you can be a radical researcher and ensure that you also feed yourself and your family. Let me introduce Professor Altvater. He will talk on these issues, and then we proceed with the lecture. So Professor Altvater is an emeritus professor from Otto-Suhr-Institut at Freie Universität Berlin. He is the author of numerous highly cited books such as The Limits of Globalization or The End of Capitalism as We Know It, and has more recently written on the issue of the Anthropocene also. But he has also been working at developing a radical political economy of the environment and has been doing so for a long time, especially in the German context. And aside from his academic career, he has devoted a lot of time to activism as well, for example, as an academic advisor of ATTAC, which is an activist platform working all over the world, now currently against austerity measures. And has been the contributor to radical journals such as Procla, which politicize, amongst other issues, the ecology. So without further ado, I would like to pass over to you, and we'll enjoy the lecture with a Q&A afterwards.
Many thanks for the kind invitation to this lecture and to participate in your network, although it's only marginal participation, but nevertheless, I'm very interested in that, what you are doing, not at least because I know, of course, some of the members of this network, of the senior members of that network. Well, the topic of this lecture this afternoon is academia, and then you said alternatives and activism, and I will change the title a little bit and say academia, activism, alternatives and activism, and then strategies for politicizing ecology in precarious times, whatever precarious times are. I first, before I start with my PowerPoint pictures, I have to apologize for my English. Since I am an emeritus or a professor in the so-called, in German, Ruhestand, that is, he is no more active at the university. I have not spoken English since a long time, and therefore it is difficult for me to switch quickly and without any difficulties into this language. But I also know that some of you, or many of you, perhaps the majority of you, are not English-speaking, originally English-speaking persons, so that you know these problems which I have, and you will be polite enough as to forget it. And secondly, this was also a reason, because I know the problem, this was also the reason why I prepared a PowerPoint session in order to facilitate the following of the ideas of the argumentation of my lecture on, as I said, academia, activism, and alternatives, strategies for politicizing ecology in precarious times. The first exhibit shows once again the lecture and its disposition, the plan of the lecture. I begin, of course, with this triple A, and the first A of the triple A. Triple A, you know, is a very good or the best note of rating agencies. And so I'm very grateful for those who formulated the title that they use this triple A. And the first A is academia, and we have to deal with theoretical approaches, with analysis, diagnosis, and perhaps also therapy. And then the second A stands for alternatives, and the third A stands for activism, for action, for collective and perhaps also individual action. The first triple A of the first A of the triple A means that we have to deal with theoretical approaches to the problems of politicizing the ecology. We first have to understand what is the ecology in our understanding, and we have to deal with the ecology because of the great transformation. You know the term of Karl Polanyi probably very well, to a capitalist market economy in the late 18th and early 19th century. The concept of Polanyi and also the concept of Karl Marx, who also spoke about this great transformation without calling it a great transformation, but calling it the original accumulation of capital, and then the accumulation process of capital as a new historical dynamic in human history. But what is the great transformation? In the understanding of Karl Polanyi, it is the disembedding of the market from society, and we have to add today, and Polanyi did not mention it explicitly, but he spoke a lot about the process which I am presenting here, and that is the disembedding from society and from nature. And then the return of these disembedded environments of the market economy as external factors, as so-called in German Sachzwänge, Sachzwang. That is an external factor which is exerting force on the social actors in a disembedded market economy. So the transformation of nature and labor power into commodities as the most outspoken and most important part of this process, it is that what Marx called the original accumulation process, and that is the emergence of the class structure of the capitalist society, and that is of the contradiction, the class conflict, and the contradiction between capital and labor. And that is the process in which the capitalist social formation is born. And we have to take into consideration that now labor as well as capital, as well as other products of labor, are becoming commodities which are traded on the market, and they have to obey to the market forces and the market rules. And that is also true for money, because money on the one hand is a mediator of all these market processes, but on the other hand, money is also a commodity which is traded on markets, on money markets, on capital markets, on markets for bonds and securities, and on financial markets. And what this means, we are experiencing today, for instance, with regard to the financial crisis, the global financial crisis, which is not over, which began perhaps 2007, 2008, but is not over today, or the euro crisis which we are facing in our continent. That is the first the starting of the first A. We have to deal with the emergence of a capitalist social formation, which is our present today. But we have to take into consideration, and that is very important for ecological analysis, we have also to deal with the problem, or with the fact, it's not a problem, with the fact that before the great transformation to a capitalist market economy, a pre-fossil capitalism already existed. I have to add that the disembedded market economy is a very dynamic social formation, but it is only dynamic because the energy it uses is a very powerful one, and the energy used above all in a market economy of our times is fossil energy, coal first, then oil and gas, and so on and so forth. And we have to be aware, because that is important for ecological questions today, that there existed already a pre-fossil capitalism. Pre-fossil capitalism, for instance, in England since the 16th or perhaps already 15th century, or in Italy in the city republics in Italy since the 12th or 13th century, that was a capitalism. And many of the institutions of a capitalist society and of the instruments of capital circulation, especially in the banking industry, have been invented in Venice, in Milano, in other Italian cities. That was capitalism, but it was a pre-fossil capitalism. And the fossil capitalism only came into existence at the end, or in the second half, let me say, of the 18th century. That was the emergence of capitalism which is following the rules of, and I use the differentiation that is of Karl Marx, which is fully using the exploitative power of capital with regard of labor. It is the so-called real subsumption of labor under capital. And today we have to add that this subsumption is also that of nature, real subsumption under the rule of capital. But in contrast to that real subsumption, there was before a so-called formal subsumption of labor and of nature under capital. That is, it was the same way of exploiting labor and nature as it was ever before. But now under the rule of capital, but then capital itself tried to change the conditions of producing surplus value to reformulate the conditions of exploitations in the sense of capitalist accumulation. That took place in the 18th century, but formal subsumption under capital existed already before this period, that is, since the 16th or even earlier centuries. And Marx also gives another differentiation between these different phases of development, and that is the absolute versus relative surplus value production. Perhaps those who are a little bit familiar with the capital of Marx know this differentiation between absolute and relative production of surplus value. The one exploitation or production of surplus value is following the integration of always more living labor in quantitative terms into the circuits of capital. And the other, the relative surplus value production, is changing the rules of the game, and that means that productivity is increasing in order to produce a growing mass of surplus value or of products which incorporate surplus value. This is important to know because of two reasons. One reason is the following one. In the history of the ecological history of the capitalist world system, there is a distinction between the fossil era and the pre-fossil era. That is also a case for the differentiation of eras of the geological formation of our planet Earth. We know all the differentiation between the Holocene, which began more or less 10,000 years ago, and then the transition from the solar energy as a basis of the energetic basis of the Holocene to the use of fossil energies at the end of the 18th century, when another geological era began. The old Holocene was over and another era began, which up to a couple of years ago had no name, but today it has a name, and that is the name Anthropocene, which has been introduced by geologists and climate scientists and many other natural scientists, not so much by social scientists, but in the meanwhile also social scientists accept this term Anthropocene in order to make this distinction between the times from the Neolithic revolution 10,000 years ago to the fossil revolution in the 18th century. But this differentiation of Marx and others is a little bit different from that which I already made, because it says that there was a period in the so-called Holocene to the capitalist system, but capitalism as a fossil energy using system only came into existence at the end of the 18th century. But capitalism as a social formation existed before, since the 13th or 14th century in Italy, and since the 16th century in England, and since the 18th, 19th century also in other countries of continental Europe. So we have to make different distinctions in order to understand what happened during the long history of mankind. And that is not only play with no importance, only for fun. It is important. It is important because I showed it last sentence on the exhibit, because it means logically, at least, if there existed a pre-fossil capitalism, then logically it's also possible that there will come a post-fossil capitalism. It might be that it is another social formation, linked to the post-fossil social system, socialism, as we called it in the 20th century, or something else, a solar society, some people call it. Non-capitalist solar society is possible, but also a post-fossil capitalism is possible. That depends on social action. Insofar, the social activities mentioned in the title of this lecture are really of importance. And we have to make our history ourselves and then decide what kind of society we want. Capitalist society of post-fossil characteristics, or another society which is also post-fossil but no more a capitalist one. But that is up to you to discuss this problem further on. The social formation of modern capitalism comes on at the end of the Holocene and the transition to the fossil and industrial capitalist society. And that has extreme consequences. I mention them because some of them are very well known and for you, and you are familiar with the problems. That is first the quantitative dimension. The quantitative dimension, that means growing or increasing growth rates of the economy. And you have to take into consideration what happens before. I use always this graph, which is based on the numbers of Angus Madison, Norwegian statistician, who published 2000, a millennial study, as it has, or millennial report, as it has been called, about the economic performance of the world economy and of parts of the world economy, of regions, of single countries. Since the year zero until our present, the present that was 1998, that is the end of the 20th century. And you see very clearly that in the whole history, the last 2,000 years, and it was not so different, but there are no numbers. The millennia before, there was no growth in the economy, or only little growth. And then the growth rate exploded at the end of the 18th century, all over the world. And that is what is quite new. And since then, we have a problem with growth. Before, there was no problem with growth. And we are bound to the growth economy and to the consequences which growth bears. And you are very familiar with that. Well, in the quantitative sense, growth comes up. And what not existed, what not was present before, and then we have also a qualitative aspect of this development, and we have to deal with the problem that growth is also accumulation of capital. So when we speak about growth and when we are criticizing the growth economy, then we have to be aware that taking this qualitative aspect into account, that we have to deal with capitalist accumulation, and that we have to interpret growth and critique of growth in terms of a critique of the social formation of capitalism. It is very far-reaching what is happening since the second half of the 18th century. A new rationality comes in. That is the birth, not by accident, of political economy. The Smithian, the book about the wealth of nations, of Adam Smith. It has been published 1776, the first publication. That is also at the end of the 18th century. It is very, very interesting and a little bit amusing that Adam Smith taught and worked at the same university in Glasgow as other scientists, James Watt, for instance, but they didn't know from each other. Cooperation beyond the limits of natural science and social science was not evident and was not there. Insofar, it was not so different from our times today. We also have problems of cooperation between natural and social scientists. They didn't know from each other. In the times when James Watt already discovered the moving power of vapor, Adam Smith only thought in terms of producing heat for workers in the factory, in the coal factories, by burning coal, not by using coal as a method, as an energy factor, in order to increase the productivity of labor. His idea of increasing productivity of labor was only division of labor, and you know very well the example which Adam Smith gave for the increase of productivity. It was not the use of fossil energy. That was what James Watt did and what he was doing research over at the same University of Glasgow. That is an example which you find in the book of Ilya Prigozhin and Isabel Stengers about the dialogue with nature. This is a very interesting example for the limitedness of scientific work. Well, the disembedded market, and that is what we have to be aware of, the disembedded market is a consequence of these developments, but the disembedded market is not a harmless pattern, as Karl Polanyi says, but it is becoming a social monstrosity, as he called it in his book about the Great Transformation. Well, in order to sum up a little bit, fossil energy plus occidental technical rationality, therefore the new role of natural sciences also, the exploitation of labor, and therefore you need also social sciences, you need also microeconomics and all that, plus money, commodification of products, disembedded markets, and exploited labor. That is what is now the entity, the totality of the capitalist system. And they are coming up in the decades to come. Natural limits, we know it from literature, peak oil, peak everything, climate crisis, crisis of modernity, of Fordism, and so on and so forth. Well, you have already seen this this graph, and I already mentioned that the history of high growth rates is a very new history, and that it has also consequences for the development of the capitalist world system. Because on the one hand, growth, W-Y, as I mentioned there in this exhibit, is the combination of the increase of labor in quantitative terms, that is the volume of labor employed by capital, on the one hand, and then the increase of productivity, that is the gross national income or gross domestic product per single worker or working hour. That depends how you go to measure it. And so long as growth is mostly dependent on labor, time, it is important that you have food, enough food, for a growing number of workers integrated into the production process. That is one of the aspects or one of the preconditions of the growth and accumulation of capital, which are mentioned by, for instance, by Jason Moore, who will come to give a talk here, as I heard, and who will be here in Berlin to give a talk on the 18th of June in the Rosa Luxemburg Foundation, which you simply find in the internet. And Jason Moore mentioned four chiefs as the precondition for the development of capitalism in recent times and responsible for the dynamics of the capitalist system. And the first of these chiefs is food. And food is absolutely important insofar as absolute surplus value production is predominant because it depends on always more workers integrated into the production process, and these workers need food. That is one of the theses of Jason Moore. And of course, this is the same what David Ricardo says in his book of 1817, when he mentions the necessity of opening the limits of or the borders of a national system in order to import goods. And that is the reason for his famous theorem on the comparative cost advantages. But why shall we open the borders in order to have these advantages? Because we have to make wage goods cheaper in order to increase the profits. All is in order to increase profits, explicitly said by David Ricardo. It is not my interpretation. It is what David Ricardo said. And the four chiefs, the first of these four chiefs, cheap food for more labor is one of the most important factors to increase the growth rate by integrating ever more workers into the capitalist production process. But then productivity becomes one of the factors of growth and of accumulation, and that means that you need machinery. And in order to build machinery, you need raw materials, and you need raw materials as cheap as possible. And you need for these machines energy to drive the machinery. And you can use biotic energy. First, it was done so. You need windmills, wind energy. You need water mills, water energy. You need animal energy for horses, of cows, and so on and so forth. And then you use fossil energy, because fossil energy is much more powerful than biotic energy and other biotic energy or renewable energy can be. So the not only food must be cheap, now also raw materials must be cheap and energy must be cheap. And as a result, also labor is becoming cheaper than it was before. So you have four chiefs, which are the basis for the development, for the fast development of the capitalist system. That is what Jason Moore says, and which is very simply to understand. Well, this is once again the idea that it is food production in agriculture that this makes possible an increase of labor to be integrated into the capitalist production process. You need the industrial revolution based on fossil energy in order to increase labor productivity, and that results in an increase of the growth rate of GDP, which has been enormous since the end of the 18th century. But then we have to take into consideration what really happened in this great transformation. One of the most important aspects is the following one. Formerly, in energy systems before the fossil revolution, before the fossil and industrial revolution, the energy system was based on solar energy, on the solar rays, which have been used by since the Neolithic revolution for sedimentary, stationary agriculture. Before that, mankind, as well as other animals, lived from hunting and gathering the fruits which are growing in wild nature. And now, after the Neolithic revolution, it was a systematic use of solar rays in order to transform this energy into that what we want, into fruits and animals and so on and so forth. But then the system changed again with the fossil and industrial revolution at the end of the 18th century, when it was fossil energy which became the most important and main driver of the economic and social and also political system. But that has one characteristic which is important to understand, because it makes the problems, most of the ecological problems which we are facing today. And that is that the inputs of our production system stem nearly completely from Earth, from the crust of the Earth, and also the outputs of our system, of our production system, are deposited in the spheres of planet Earth. The emissions, the gasic emissions in the atmosphere, the liquid emissions in the oceans and the rivers, and the solid emissions in the terrestrial grounds of the Earth or in the lithosphere. So all spheres are loaded with emissions which have a negative effect, as we know, on the ecological stability of the spheres of our planet Earth. That is a problem resulting from closing the energy system against the solar rays and by using the fossil energy which we find in the crust of planet Earth. In order to understand the consequences of this planetary trajectory from an energetically open to an energetically closed system, one has to take into consideration one of the crucial categories in the Marxian theory, and that is the double character of human labor, of human products, of, we can say, all economic processes. Because this double character allows to distinguish and to bring it together as parts of a totality. It allows to distinguish between the ecological transformations in nature by producing use values, useful products for the satisfaction of our lives. That is what Nicolas Georgescu-Roegen, one of the most prominent ecological economists, as you know, said when he developed the entropy increasing activities of human being, he asked himself in his most important book of 1971, he asked himself, why do people do that stupid things to increase entropy instead of doing better things? And he answered, yes, we do that because of the enjoyment of life. We want to satisfy our needs, and by satisfying the need, in order to satisfy the needs, we have to produce, and when we are producing, we inevitably increase the entropy of the whole system of our planetary system, and at the end of the day, we have planetary ecological problems, and we don't know how to resolve them. That is the consequence of that. Well, and due to the double character, we have also to distinguish between different measures of these changes in a double sense. On the value side, the economic sphere, we have one measure which is the most important one, although it appears in different forms. It is a profit rate. It's a profit rate which always shows the result of a process and the inputs necessary to produce these results. And we try to increase the profit rate or the rentability, as it's called, or in Keynesian terms, it has different names for the same relation between the result and the input in order to achieve this result. And secondly, we have another measure, and that is the energy return on energy invested, the ROI, which is used by energy scientists, by technicians, and so on and so forth, because it is important to know how much energy must be used in order to produce a certain amount of new energy. And Joseph Grögen said, yes, look to the Neolithic revolution. It was very simple to have a piece of wood set into fire by accident. For instance, in nature during a storm, and then a whole wood is burning, and then the ash is a wonderful method in order to make fruitful land. It is very, very few energy invested in order to produce a lot more of energy useful for human beings and perhaps also for other beings. That is a very high energy return on energy invested. And we can use this relation for many other processes in our world, and therefore we can also understand the fossil appetite in modern times since the 18th century. What are the advantages of fossil energy compared to other energies? They have a very high energy return on energy invested. That's the first point. And the second is that fossil energy and the use of fossil energy is independent on time and space. You can use this everywhere. You can transport fossil energy very simply from one place to another place. And you can use it today or you use it tomorrow. You can store it also rather simply, much more simply than solar energy. You can store coal and a barrel of oil from today until 10 years later. You cannot store in the same way solar energy. That is a great advantage of fossil energy, also important now for energy for political questions around the use of energy and the introduction of renewable energies, which you are, I think, very familiar with. And then there's a third advantage, which is not unimportant, because fossil energy serves exclusively the capital. Fossil energy reserves can be transferred totally into private property and thus into a stock of capital. That is not possible with solar energy. It's a great advantage. And you find it, for instance, in such ridiculous developments like the overestimation of reserves by Shell, for instance, and the correction of this overestimated reserve, because the higher reserves in the balance of the Shell company means that there is much more capital in the Shell company, and that the value on the stock exchange market is increasing, and therefore not geologists show that the reserves are lower than declared by Shell, but the American Federal Reserve declared Shell as a fraudulent company because it has upgraded their fossil reserves in a manner and in a way that is not possible and not allowed. Well, the advantage of fossil energy, therefore, is first independence on space and time. Secondly, it is exclusively for capital because they can be transferred into reserves. And thirdly, the biotic rhythms are more and more unimportant in comparison to the rhythms of capital development. So the consequences are an increase of the growth rate, but in the social form of capital accumulation. We have always to be aware on that. Here you find some numbers on the so-called ROA, which come from a book by Heinberg, who is one of the most important ecologists in Canada. And energy invested is one in the case of crude oil, and the energy which is the result of this investment is 19 times higher. And therefore, it shows very well the importance of fossil energy for the development of capitalism. And to take into account and be aware that the relation of energy invested to energy return is the same relation in a formal sense than the relation between profits and the costs to produce that profit. It is European rationality which is virulent in both areas of this double characterized process. But we have to be aware that all these processes are taking place into a social formation, and that the increase of economic growth turns into a fetishism of grouse, an exaggeration which is very well known and very important, and for ecologists one of the points of critique of the capitalist system. And the fetishism of grouse is very clear. For instance, today, first, in Germany we have a Wachstumsbeschleunigungsgesetz, a growth acceleration law, as if it was, would be possible to declare or to increase growth rates by law. But it's not only Germany which makes this nonsense, but also in Brazil, done by a left government, was the same, happened the same. They have developed or established in the year 2011, I guess, a pact, a social pact on the acceleration of growth. It was a Lula government who made this pact for the acceleration, not only for growth, but for the acceleration of growth, as in Germany. So that is the first example for this fetishism. The second is a World Bank declaration, growth is good for the poor. The poor are the result of non-growth or low growth, and increase growth, then you are abolishing poverty in society. It is nonsense. I could say a lot about that, but I will leave it aside, because we have also to see that only in a growing economy jobs are created. Also, that is one of the fetishized sayings in this debate, and nobody takes into consideration that growth is a consequence of investments, and investments can be job creating investments, yes, but also jobs reducing investment. Investment of rationalization, for instance, they are reducing the number of jobs and not increasing them. But in the public debate, you never hear that. You always hear, yes, growth is good for the jobs. Trade unions say that, and corporations, companies say that. The politicians say that, from green parties to the conservative parties, says nearly no difference at all. And growth is also important to come out of the debt crisis. That is what is said to the indebted euro countries today, to Greece and Portugal and so on. Curb growth in order to come out of the debt debacle. Well, and the growth rate also, and that is the peak of fetishism. The growth is also a measure, a benchmark for the performance of a given country. And what happens in the course of economic growth? I only mention two aspects. The first is the cyclical aspect, and we would have to deal with the cyclical crisis in the growth or accumulation process of capital, which is a well-known discourse in traditional critical economic theory, in Marxism as well as in Keynesianism. But the other problem, which is more important for our discourse, are the cumulative effects of growth. On the one hand, economic cumulative effects, and that is concentration and centralization of capital, the growth of the companies, and so on and so forth, and the accumulation of immaterial capital, of knowledge, information, etc., and so on. And it is absolutely clear that these cumulative processes are uneven and unequal in the world, in each country as well as in the world, in totality. And that means that in the course of capitalist growth, it is unavoidable, inevitable, that inequality is increasing. And now we would have to deal with the Piketty debate, for instance. His book, some of you perhaps have read it, The Capital in the 21st Century, that is showing how inequality is an outcome of the capitalist dynamics and that we have to fight it by increasing the public sector and the tax on capital in order to avoid, these cumulative effects which are so conflict-loaden that we have to find some solutions for the problem. But of course it is in our context even more important that these cumulative effects also exist in nature due to the transformations of matter and energy. Entropy increased, that has been already mentioned. Unless new energy is imported in order to compensate for the increase of entropy. That is always possible, but it is practically not realizable. That is a big problem, because we are not able to use the energy of the sun in order to compensate for the increase of entropy. Or we have not found the solution for the problem. Perhaps we are optimistic enough to say there is a solution, at least. We did not find it until now, but we can find it. But it is also a good, interpretation that it is impossible to find such a solution due to natural laws. Well, the cumulative effects in the economic system, in the of the economic system, have their repercussions in the ecological world system. And that is one of the reasons also why we have to analyze not only the world economy and the world economic system, like Wallerstein and others, but also to take into account that we have to deal with the world ecological system, and that this world ecological system has a certain trajectory of its development, which I only mention here. But the cumulative effects also have as a consequence that the development, the accumulation process, the growth process is reaching certain limits and transgressing these limits. For instance, I mention here rather famous, and perhaps some of you have already seen this wonderful exhibit, some of the limits of the world system, the world ecological system, already are reached or transgressed. The limits of the climate system, the extinction of species, and the laws of evolution of species, and then the nitrogen cycle. These are limits which already are reached. Others are not reached, or we know not enough about it, but we have to be very, very aware of the dangers in which the mankind is going by following or by continuing the accumulation path as in the past. And that is why Naomi Klein, in her famous book, this changes everything, capitalism versus climate, concludes in order to save the climate, it is necessary to fight capitalism. That is a reversal of the interpretation of the collapse in the last century, when everybody, or the left people, always said the collapse of capitalism is possible. It is an economic and political and social collapse, perhaps as a result of class struggle, or even not as a result of class struggle in the theory of Grossman, for instance. And now it is very clear that it is the climate with and other natural systems which are threatened by a collapse, and that due to the double character, we have to deal with capitalism and fight capitalism in order to prevent this kind of collapse. Well, we could use a lot more of information on this coming possible collapse. I have some of the impact dynamics, but the consequence is that we have to take into account that human beings in the meanwhile make planetary history, and therefore it is perhaps justified to call the new era after the Industrial Revolution of the 18th century the Anthropocene. And that is what many geologists and climate scientists, natural scientists in general, do. And there's a broad debate internationally on the Anthropocene. But we have to take into account also that humans make history in a well-defined social formation, in the capitalist social formation, and therefore perhaps it is justified not to call it Anthropocene without mentioning that it is capitalism in which human beings are acting collectively and not something else. And secondly, we have to take into account the double character of social processes, of the impact on the social and economic system, also on cultural and political processes, as well as the impact on nature. And therefore, it is necessary not only to speak about the capitalist social formation. This is a very well-known formula, which is is widespread and well accepted. But perhaps it is necessary to speak about today of the Kapitalocene, because it also the geological formation influenced by human activities today, and therefore Kapitalocene is integrating the aspect of the social formation of capitalism on the one hand and of the ecological consequences of human development under capitalism, and that is accepted by the term Kapitalocene. The already mentioned Jason Moore also uses this term Kapitalocene. Well, the second A of the triple A, very briefly, is alternatives. In the Kapitalocene, alternatives also have a planetary reach. This is the first that we have to be aware of. And there are big alternatives run by big political powers. Of course, the United States of America, by big corporations like the Bill Gates Corporation, Microsoft and Google and so on, they are in the meanwhile exerting alternatives on a planetary scale. And they are targeting all Earth systems. The system of information, the system of the economy, the energy system, the system of mining raw materials and so on, the climate system, the genetic pools of life development, development of life, evolution of life, and so on. And this shows you that the problem which you can read in the newspapers today and tomorrow about NSA, in that is information, global information system, and on the one hand, and climate change on the other, and the economic world crisis on the third hand, that they have to do with each other. They are not to be discussed, debated in different disciplines or different discourses. They have to do with each other, because information is necessary for the economy as well as for ecology and dealing with nature and so on, and therefore they are belonging together. That is very, very important for alternative practice. And therefore, we have to be aware that the world is on the crossroads. On the one hand, the natural crisis, ecological issues, and they are dealt with by means of geoengineering. There are in the last years have been published many, many books on geoengineering, not by accident. And geoengineering always means that you deal with these problems on a planetary, geological basis and level. And yeah, by, for instance, radiation management, make the sun a factor which is not heating the planet anymore, make it dark, that is, shut the planet Earth vis-a-vis the rays of the sun even more than it has been done by the transformation to the fossil energy instead of solar energy. Continue with that what has been begun in the 18th century, but make it more radical and more efficiently, technologically. And that is what geoengineers tell you. You can read, when you go into the internet, a lot of papers and articles with this intention and this message. Well, I will not speak more about that, not on carbon dioxide removal and so on. There are many, many other problems which we could deal with, but only tell about the alternative. And that is a moral economy, a solidarity economy in a very narrow space on the local and so on and so forth. That could be an alternative, which is an alternative which is already present in the development of our days. There is, on the one hand, the history of capitalist growth, which I already spoke about it, but there is also the history of morale, of communalism, reciprocity, solidarity, of an alternative economy, and there are many initiatives in the world which follow this alternative line. And that is where activism, the third A of the triple A, is emerging and becomes important for the further debates. There are many examples of this development, the reappropriation of public spaces and of the commons on a local or the regional, national, and global level. There are examples from Latin America, for instance, or also from Europe about these developments, which I only mention here and go not into detail in order to to describe it. In order to conclude, there is a great challenge to develop a new culture of cooperation between new social movement and movements and traditional ones, for instance, the trade unions, about which I did not speak until now, but they are important as actors. When we speak about actors, and we cannot forget them. We have also to bring different strands of thinking in social sciences together in order to better approach the millennial economic, social, and ecological challenges. And we have to overcome the divide between the hard sciences, natural sciences, and the soft, so-called soft social sciences, because this division is no more viable in the Kapitalocene. When we are speaking about the double character and about energy transformation and transformation of matter and the emissions and the inputs of this transformation, then of course we have to take also natural science as social scientists into account, as well as natural scientists have to take social science results into account, into their discourses. When we want to understand the Kapitalocene and to build alternatives, we cannot work in a different way. We have to understand the world as, that is the word of Friedrich Engels in his book on the dialectics of nature, as a dialectical totality, and we have to deal with all the ingredients of this totality. That is what I wanted to tell you about the politicizing ecology. And in order to end, I say that the last, what I said about the dialectics or the dialectical totality, you find in the work that is of Friedrich Engels about the dialectics of nature. And it is good to mention it, because this book has been published exactly 90 years ago. So it has an anniversary. And this is the reason why we perhaps have a look into such a book, which tries to combine the natural sciences and the social sciences in a dialectical way. Thanks a lot for your attention, and we have time to discuss. Yeah.
Thank you very much for this lecture. It seems like we should not be leaving the three A's to the hard sciences, to geoengineers and so on, especially the three A's in the age of the Anthropocene. Thank you very much for this lecture. We're now going to go to a Q&A.
It seems to me that the alternatives that you were pointing at, that is solidarity-based, moral-based, local, the community forms of organization, they have been, as you rightly pointed out, have been of all times. They have paralleled capitalism all the time. Do they therefore, given the historical record, are not very effective at counterbalancing, let alone overcoming, the formidable forces of the Kapitalocene that you described? So is the alternative that you're suggesting not a bit thin, given the extraordinary challenges that you so eloquently described? And then secondly, quickly, although in the title of your talk you mentioned politicization, but I did not find politicization in the description of your alternatives. So I would like to push you a bit more on this field of alternatives and to ask whether we can move beyond these localized, solidarity-based community forms of organization, however important they are.
Thanks a lot for the comment. It was not a question, but a comment. And I agree with many of your ideas you mentioned. There was always in history a parallel history of profit-making, simply said, and a moral dimension. That is what E.P. Thompson already in his paper on the moral economy more than 20 years ago already wrote, and which is important also in the writings of Marx and Engels. They also were aware of this moral side of the development of capitalism. Today, we have still the same parallelity between, on the one hand, profit making, accumulation and growth, and on the other side, solidarity and so on and so forth. In other parts of the world, perhaps more outspoken than in Europe, that depends from country to country, and not only from country to country, but from cultures in these countries to cultures in other countries. But on the other hand, we have to be aware that in the world today, we have many of these alternatives. 2 years ago, no, 3 years ago, there was a year of the cooperation declared by the United Nations. And in the run of this year of the corporations, there were also some numbers about the development of the numbers of cooperatives. And Ban Ki-moon, the Secretary of the United Nations, said that it's 700 million people in the world working in cooperatives, in energy cooperatives. There's a boom of founding energy cooperatives of alternative energies in Germany, for instance, and in other European countries. It is not so different. But in the world, in some, there are 700 million people working in cooperatives, energy cooperatives, as I said, but production cooperatives, housing cooperatives, land cooperatives, and so on and so forth. There are many of these forms. And that means that when you multiply 700 with 3 as members of families, that 2 billion, more or less 2 billion men and women are working under different conditions than the normal capitalist ones. That is sometimes not the best way of building alternatives, because some of these cooperatives are full of precarious work and so on. That is not only a friendly perspective. We have to add, we have to be realistic, but it is an alternative, especially in times of a crisis of the profit system, as we are experiencing it today in Greece or in Portugal, and 10 years ago in Argentina, for instance. Then there is a boom of solidarity economy, of cooperatives mostly. And in Argentina, 2001, in the big crisis, there was a boom of the foundation of cooperatives as children of emergency. There was no way out. Those who are following the profit principle are closing the shops and throwing workers out of the shop. And what shall they do? They have no alternative as to make their own organization, their own shop, and that is in forms of cooperatives or in other forms. I was in Argentina in those times, and, around the 2000-2001, in this big crisis. And there were many indigenous persons from the Mapuche, for instance, they remembered their old forms of cooperative work. That is not so cooperative as we know it here in Europe or in Latin America in a formal sense. It is different, and the principles are different with which they organize the alternative. That means there is the alternative, but we are in the trap which you mentioned. On the global level, and when it must be global, there the big firms, the big corporations, the big states, the big governments, and so are predominant, are ruling. And it is very hard to find a way to build alternatives against this power. It's a power structure which also is present in the world today, and it's very hard to overcome it.
To some extent, you already started to detail a little bit your ideas, your vision of specific kinds of cooperatives in this case, that you would consider an alternative. I would be interested to find out a bit more about your idea of the moral economy. So what would be the role of the state in such a moral economy? What is to do with property rights in such a moral economy, and how about the system of international institutions? How do we have to imagine that? And in a sense, you said quite rightly that Google, Facebook, these have a global reach, and that can be portrayed as a force of change, and it is changing things, but I guess they may not be organized in the way that we want them to be organized. How would these need to be organized to be part of a moral economy in a productive way? Thanks.
Yeah, we are of course in a stalemate, because on the one hand we are dealing with global problems, but we have no global actors. On the other hand, we have very powerful actors on the state level, national state. We have international organizations also. We have on the global level only big NGOs, which are part of the power structure of what has been called, or what is called, the governance structure of the world. And there's a big debate on the question whether this governance structure can be overcome by a world civil society or the global civil society, a movement that is the idea of the scientific council of in ecological questions of the German government, for instance. But it is not possible to have alternatives on a global scale and actors on a global scale which are following a non-big energy alternative or production or also consumption alternative. That must be done on the local or on smaller scale. Otherwise, I think it is impossible. And we have to develop some new forms of networking in order to bring these local initiatives together to form a global power structure out of it. And of course, you need some programmatic ideas for that. For that, we need theory. And a theory which is able to understand the ecological as well as the economic and social and cultural dimensions of such an initiative. We have to work about it. I think nobody has a solution for this problem. But we must be able to formulate the questions and find then in a common achievement answers on these questions we are posing. That is what I can say at the moment about this question. And on a national level, there's a lot of ideas and many groups working on alternative, for instance, alternative economics, alternative environmental issues. There's so much that we there's plenty of ideas of this kind, but it is always to the question or the problem or the difficulty to bring all these ideas to the ground, where actors are trying to change the situation. And that has to be done immediately and always near to the problem, exposed, and therefore general ideas, sometimes much more useful than concrete programs which show that they are not concrete enough in case that they have to be realized. That's a general problem, not only today and for us, but for everybody who is trying to formulate alternative ideas and to bring them into reality.
The great transformation period was followed also by the great colonialism. So what's the role that you put on colonialism and so the possibilities of new other alternatives to the colonial alternatives, and also the role of the state on that? The example that you gave on the Mapuches, I think, also plays with this against not only the economic concentration, accumulation, but also as a freedom of other possibility of existence. Usually we tend to think that all these movements are local and capital would be global. And then we can realize, I'm coming from South America, then the majority are local and the minority, that would be capital. I would see lots of poor people, impoverished people, and indigenous group, which are almost the majority of the world in somehow. I don't know if that's local or global struggle. I'm very confused with these two concepts.
I'm not sure that I understood everything what you said, but the colonial system, of course, came up also with at the end or at the beginning of capitalism. In the 15th century, as the world systems theory says that the capitalist system had a political origin, and that was the peace treaty of after the 30 Years' War in Europe, 1648, and an economic origin that was the discovery of the Americas by Columbus in 1492, and between 1492 and 1548, 150 years or so, that is, in the words of Fernand Baudel, the long 16th century. That was a decisive epoch of the development of the capitalist world system, and this world system existed or consisted above all from colonies. And therefore, colonialism is one of the main factors of capitalist development, and that is well known and well analyzed because colonialism was a basis of primitive accumulation. It was a basis of the riches in the European colonial powers. It was the reason of the growth and the emergence of Great Britain as a superpower, and with the silver from the colonies in Latin America and so on, the capitalist accumulation has been powered. And David Ricardo, whom I already quoted, was well aware in his famous example between the exchange between Portugal and England, that was an exchange between these two countries, but on the basis of the silver which has been imported from the Latin American colonies, the Portuguese and Spanish colonies. So we have to be aware that this world systemic approach is a necessary approach in order to understand the long-term development of modern capitalism, and that is not wrong today. We have still to take into account how the different minerals, the different energetic sources work together and make up what is modern capitalism and which is the reason of its dynamics. That is what with regard to colonialism, but there was also another aspect in your question, which I have not in my mind at the moment. Perhaps you can repeat it, if possible.
The possibility to think alternatives in the colonial times, because you were mentioning the colonialism on America, but actually in the 19th century here in Berlin, the world was redivided in 1885, which was following the second industrial revolution and increasing the accelerationism. But my question is more on thinking alternatives, because the Mapuche example that you gave is also being repressed by other forms of coloniality, I would say, Lula in Brazil. So how could we imagine new other possibilities to move out of capitalism and also of colonialism?
No, it is not not simply possible to move out of capitalism, because capitalism is not a building where you can move out, and then the building is empty, and perhaps it breaks down because there is nobody anymore. So it is not. You have to build another building in the old building. That is the question. That is, you have to renovate so capitalism, so long as it exists as a social, dominant social formation, and then build it in such a way that perhaps the building becomes another one, a better one, a nicer one, a more comfortable one, which we then no more call capitalism, house of capitalism, but house of somewhat else, of a solar society, of solidarity society, of socialism maybe, and so on and so forth. So this is a big problem which is very actual today. I remember what the Greek finance minister Varoufakis said or wrote. He said or wrote that we first have to save capitalism in order to avoid the problems which would break down of capitalism or of certain parts of the capitalist development, that is the debt crisis of European capitalism, because it has so many tragical and negative effects on people that we have to avoid this kind of collapse of capitalism, and therefore we have to save it. We have to save it in order to have the time to build something better, new. And that is all, still a dilemma which already existed all over the century, but people or parties or intellectuals were not so aware of these difficulties as we are today.
Thank you. I think my question is related to what you just said about building a new building from inside. I think I liked a lot.
The microphone is on.
Yes. Okay. Just referring to what you just said and your last slide, when you push for the need to develop strategic concepts, I like that. I think I like that idea. I wonder if this concept of capitalocene is one of those strategic concepts. Otherwise, could you maybe give an example or further develop this idea of strategic concepts?
In my opinion, the Kapitalocene is not an alternative. It is a continuation of capitalist development. Because of the double character of capitalism, because it in modern times is not only creating a social world system, the capitalist world system, not as a social and economic one alone, but also affecting the spheres, the ecological spheres of planet Earth. And some of the data I showed you, the effect on the climate system, the effect on the exploitation of energy sources, of fossil energy, and so on and so forth. These are, all of them, effects of the capitalist, of the dynamics of the capitalist mode of production. And so far, the Kapitalocene is not an alternative. We have to find alternatives to the Kapitalocene. And that is, insofar, very important, as it shows that we have not only to find alternatives to the capitalist social formation, but also alternatives to the effects of the social formation on the Earth systems, on the geological and other Earth systems, inclusive the information system. And NSA and the scandal around it makes it clear that there are connections in this dialectic totality of capitalist formation, social formation, geological formation, and ecological formation. That is what we have to be aware of. And then the next step, we can try to build or to conceptualize utopian, of course, alternatives to this Kapitalocene. And in my opinion, these alternatives must be small, not too small, must be networks, very lively networks, must be based on alternative energy, that is renewable energy, that is the energy flow of the sun, of the rays of the sun, and not the stocks of fossil energy in the crust of the Earth. And then we have also to take into account the consequences for our social formation. And since there was always the parallelity, we spoke about that, of profit-making capitalism on the one hand, on the other hand, solidarity, morality. So we have to build it more on solidarity and on morale in order to find an alternative in difference to the predominant capitalist trajectory.
Hi. You talked about a little bit about global governance. You mentioned global governance and the possibility of global civil society rising up to a more prominent position or more prominent role, let's say. I'd like to know a little bit about how do you see the possibility, or do you see the possibility of the existing? Do you see the possibility of the existing global governance institution, basically the UN system, United Nations system, playing any relevant role in this future or upcoming scenario at all, or do you think they are ill-equipped to do that?
I would like to see some possibilities, some hope, and some positive perspectives, but I am rather pessimistic with regard to the today dominating governance structures. They have not brought what they should bring together. They are no alternatives. The scientific council of in Germany, of scientific council, Wissenschaftlicher Beirat, globale Umwelt, global environmental policy, so it's called, has not brought convincing proposals for this issue. Why? I think, first of all, And that has to do with the subject of this lecture, this triple A. First of all, I think because I have a very poor analytical approach, they are not critical enough. I think it is impossible today to approach ecological issues as economic and social issues as well, without taking the Marxian approach of the double character into account. And they don't do that. They explicitly deny it, because Marxism, that is from yesterday or the day before yesterday and so on, it has nothing to do with our real and problems which are so burning. Well, that is the first which we have to take into account. We must be more open-minded in our analytical approaches in order to develop alternatives. And secondly, the WGU, the Scientific Council, has a very optimistic and perhaps even naive understanding of social movements, of social actors. Because these social movements and social actors, of course, are living in a very contradictory environment. Why should they not be very contradictory and conflict prone? And they are. And they must be prepared for the upcoming conflicts. And some of them do that and others do not. And the Scientific Council says there are no conflicts, a little bit exaggerated. There are no conflicts, or we can resolve these conflicts within the framework of our political understanding of in Germany and in Europe and perhaps also in the world. That is what makes a problem. We must to take into account that there are conflicts, that there are contradictions, that there are different actors with different interests, and that they must come together, and not always they come together. They separate sometimes, and we have to find projects and projections, utopian projections mostly, which can bring them together.
Thank you. I wanted to ask you if you could say a few words about your experience working with ATTAC as an academic advisor, because most of us here are PhD students and we've been discussing for a while now about how to put our academic knowledge to use in engaged ways. Thank you.
May I pose a question? From which country do you come?
Italy.
What?
Italy.
Italy, okay. Okay, in Italy you have also ATTAC. And I'm not 100% familiar with ATTAC in Italy. But they have also, as I know, the Scientific Council. And the Scientific Council, that is nothing special. It is an important body, of course. When you are a member of such a body, it is important for you. But whether it is important for ATTAC or for society or for Europe, that is a question which I cannot answer. What we are doing, I can tell you. It is education. ATTAC organizes summer academies about the issues of concern in the world of today. That is peace and war in Europe. That is the integration process, a project in Europe. That is the state of the environment, that is the development issue and the growth issue linked to it, related to it, and so on and so forth. And there are debates about it, and that is, in the best sense, alphabetization, as Pierre Bourdieu called it, alphabetization of social movements. And as a scientific council or as a member of the scientific council, I try to promote this project of alphabetization, of ecological and economic alphabetization in order to be in, to be able to formulate alternatives to that what the government and other actors are promoting and proposing. That is mostly what we are doing. First, on the national level, the once a year, 1 week, summer academy, then twice, all second year, and summer academy on a European level in order to meet ATTAC people and others from other European countries in order to organize some exchange on a European level, what is a big problem because of the different languages we are all speaking, and not everybody from Italy or from France or from Germany speaks English. That is a lingua franca in ATTAC on the European level. So you have a lot of problems, and we have not the means which the formal institutions have to organize efficient and good translation of different languages. Well, and then ATTAC organizes these kind of meeting, alphabetization, but also is engaged in campaigns. Campaigns of Blockupy, for instance. ATTAC is a member of Blockupy movement, is active in the campaign against the debt crisis now in Greece and in other European countries, in order to find a solution and in order to also protect the people against the Troika, against the creditors, and so on and so forth. There are a lot of many other examples which I could tell you, but perhaps it's first enough.
Thank you very much. I really liked your lecture. And I have two or three questions. The first, you talked about angles and the dialectics of nature. I don't know, I'm not that familiar with the work of Engels, but the idea that I have is that Engels was not properly an environmentalist. In reality, between Engels and Marx, Engels was seen as more with a positivist and favoring the progressive forces of production and so on. So I would like to ask if is there any other author, maybe more contemporaneous, that could, let's say, be a good reference in approaching the dialectics between nature and society. And secondly, when you talk about the alternatives and the importance of building moral economies, solidarity economies, of networking, what I miss probably is also to engage with something that was key for Marx's work, that is related with the class struggle, and how to see this in general terms. If we consider capitalism as a social totality in contradiction, seeing class struggle not only as the conflict in the workplace and between worker and the boss, but how to see this kind of small local alternatives within a broader context that is of struggling the hegemony of the ruling classes. And maybe you have been in Argentina. What happened in Argentina, all these solidarity economies, it is clear how they participated in a conflictual situation that probably we can say it is class struggle, but we can look at Argentina now and also to see what happened. So should we also take lessons and, let's say, nowadays think a bit more on how to make these connections between this kind of alternatives and the more classic movements, and how to deal with it, and also how, if there is, how do you, you talked about the importance of networking and going global. We had already the anti-globalization movement that was very global and making these kinds of networking. But also, this was a declined, this movement. And thinking of this, how do you see the role today of the states and the control that the states still have in terms of building consent, of coercion, and how to articulate the local, the global, with the national level?
Yes, so we stay here until tomorrow morning. Until breakfast, yeah, in order to resolve all these problems you mentioned. Yes, but first, Engels. I 4 weeks ago or so, I published a small book on the dialectics of nature of Engels in German, so not all of you can read it. And I read, of course, the dialectics of nature anew, and several times anew. And I can tell you, in Engels you find very, very many ecological aspects of social sciences. He first of all studied natural sciences in order to understand better the industrial system. And Engels was it who said, who invented all these things going into natural sciences in Manchester, where he worked in a factory. And in the industrial system, which was very present in Manchester, where the industrialization had its origin, and Engels was with it. He was there, one of the promoters of it, because he was a capitalist in those times. Therefore, he knew very exactly that to understand the process of industrialization, you must study first political economy and criticize it. Therefore, critique of political economy. And that was the idea of Karl Marx. And Engels followed it. And secondly, you have to take into account all that what is the material side of the production process, the production of use values. And use values are made from energy and matter. So you have to deal with energy and matter and the transformation processes of energy and matter. That is with machinery, and that means that you have to study technical developments, technique. And technology. And secondly, it's made out of, it's also a process of transformation of energy. So you have to look into the problems of transforming energy. What happens when you transform energy stored in coal, for instance, into electricity? That was one of the questions of Engels. What is done by this? That is a thermodynamic question. And so he was very keen on these new developments in technical and natural science development. And he was well aware, and I could give you many citations, quotations, which prove it. He was well aware on the destructive side of capitalist production processes, which are at the same time, and the productive forces, he said, are at the same time destructive forces. You can use the same machinery for producing consumption goods and for producing weapons, for instance, and you are always producing emissions in a gasic form and so on and so forth. So he knew that, and it is important to know and good to see that Karl Marx, who was also well aware of the ecological problems, always asked his friend Friedrich Engels, when he met some of the problems of natural sciences or of nature, which he could not resolve. For instance, there's a very, very famous exchange of letters between Engels and Marx on the so-called Podolinsky question. You know it. Oh, okay. Then I have not to repeat. And Paul Burkert another Paul Burkert and Bellamy Foster. I apologize. They wrote a book about a long article about the Podolinsky question, about the ecological Engels and Marx. And those who did not read it, that is not you, they should do that because it is a very important question for the understanding of Marxist approach to the ecological question. Second, the alternatives. Of course, these alternatives are developed in traditional organizations, parties as well as trade unions. And that was the discourse of the 70s, perhaps also the 50s and 60s of the last century. And only in the new century, the ecological question becomes part of the alternative part of the discourse on alternatives. In Germany, we have the so-called memorandum group, perhaps you know it. They publish an annual memorandum for an alternative economic policy. And also on a European level, there exists now since 5 years or so an Euro memorandum with proposals for an alternative economic policy, very concrete proposals concerning fiscal policy, labor market policy, monetary policy, foreign policy, and so on and so forth, and also environmental policy. That is always a chapter in this Euro memorandum. Insofar also in traditional organizations, in the traditional approaches, academic approaches, there is a new interest and a new attention on these ecological questions. But they have to be brought together with the other alternative dialogues and discourses coming from alternative movements, which do not belong to the traditional organizations, such as environmental groups, women's groups, and so on and so forth. And ad hoc groups, for instance, in the context of the contemporary Greek crisis. And we have to bring them together. And that can only be done either on a personal level, that is, one meets another, or in an organized form in meetings which combine the different strands of thinking and experiences. And that is also done in many, many countries and over the borders of the countries also, beyond the borders.
Okay, thank you very much for this lecture. Thank you for your questions. And have a good evening.
And for the answers.
Yeah, the answers.